Macmillan Audio presents Molly by Colin Butcher. Read for you by Colin Butcher.
They are called sleuth hounds by the people. These dogs have such a marvellous cleverness that they seek for thieves and follow them only by the scent of the goods that are taken away. The History and Chronicles of Scotland, 1536. 1. Molly's First Test. At 9 a.m. on Friday, the 3rd of February, 2017, just as my assistant, Sam, had settled at her desk, booted up her computer, and taken her first sip of espresso, the telephone rang. I was outside on the Bramble Hill farm driveway, preparing to exercise Molly in the early morning sun. My cocker spaniel had woken up in a particular frisky mood, so much so that she'd knocked over my girlfriend Sarah's favourite Ladro vase in the hallway, and she needed to run off some excess energy. UK Pet Detectives, said Sam, picking up the phone. Can we help? I really hope so, replied a glum male voice. Our cat Rusty has gone missing. We've looked everywhere, but there's no sign of her. We've hit a brick wall, really, so we thought we'd give you guys a call. Tim was a graphic designer who lived in the Hertfordshire city of St. Albans with his physiotherapist girlfriend, Jasmine. They were saving hard for a deposit for a two-bedroom house. But in the meantime, we're renting a modest first-floor apartment in a quiet cul-de-sac. The couple shared a love of cats and had gladly welcomed little Rusty into their lives, a black, white and copper rescue moggy with almond-shaped eyes and long, fluffy tail. Since the flat was pretty cramped, many of their personal belongings were still boxed up, they often let their cat outdoors. There she'd mooch around the crescent, lazing on driveways and sitting on doorsteps, neither straying too far nor staying out too late. The previous Friday, however, Rusty had failed to turn up for her weekly treat of steamed haddock. She adored her fresh fish, and her owners were totally flummoxed. It's just so out of character, Tim told Sam. We spent the whole weekend searching in streets and gardens. We've even printed out leaflets and posters. But she's nowhere to be found. We're at a total loss. I'm so sorry to hear that, said Sam, who, being a cat owner herself, genuinely felt their pain. Leave it with me. I'll have a word with my boss and I'll get back to you. She promptly bounded over to the large sash window and yanked it up. Colin, she yelled, causing Molly and me to stop dead in our tracks as we strode towards the meadow. Make sure you pop in after your training session. Think I might have found Molly's first proper job. Fast forward half an hour and I was sitting in the office discussing Rusty's disappearance with Sam while a bushwhacked Molly enjoyed a snooze. I felt my pulse quicken as my colleague reiterated her conversation with Tim and outlined the missing pet's circumstances. If our inaugural cat-seeking assignment was to be a success, the search conditions had to be as favourable as possible, and this seemed to tick all the boxes. Firstly, Rusty came from a single cat household, thus enabling me to obtain a decent hair sample and giving Molly the best chance of isolating the scent and matching it to the lost cat. Secondly, the puss had been missing for less than a week, which increased the likelihood of finding her alive. Also working in our favour was the fact that the weather was calm and settled, unseasonably so in fact, for early February. Any excess winds or any form of precipitation, rain, snow or mist for example, would dilute the cat scent and would interfere with my dog's ultra-sensitive nose. Luckily, as a former serviceman, I was well-versed in all things meteorological and geographical. Prior to my long career in the police force, I'd spent over a decade in the Royal Navy, which had prompted a serious interest in weather, climate, and coastal navigation. I had studied all subjects voraciously in my cabin on HMS Illustrious, expanding my scientific knowledge on air masses, frontal systems, and cartography, for instance, and had become something of an expert. Little did I know then how useful this knowledge would become in the world of pet detection. In December 2016, Molly had completed an intensive period of scent recognition training at a Milton Keynes-based charity, Medical Detection Dogs. And since then, she and I had staged countless practice scenarios at my Bramble Hill Farm HQ, honing our skills in preparation for our first real-life search for a missing cat. I'd been quietly confident that Molly and I had attained the required level of competence, but it was only when I'd sent some video footage of our training to the experts at MDD that we'd finally been given the green light. "From what we've seen, we think you're both ready for your first proper search," they said, causing a tingle to shoot up my spine. "Your interaction and teamwork are excellent, and, as far as we're concerned, you're good to go." Now, following Sam's phone conversation, I finally faced the prospect of solving a live search with Molly by my side. I felt a mixture of exhilaration and trepidation. I'd spent so much time and energy developing my innovative cat detection dog idea. It had been 5 years in the making, and, having eventually found my perfect sidekick, I was desperate for that conclusive proof of concept to make all of our hard work worthwhile. "This could be it," I said to Sam. "This could be Molly's first test." "Oh my goodness, how exciting," grinned my colleague. That evening I spent an hour or so on the phone to Tim, obtaining as much background information as possible. I asked him whether there'd been any triggers that might have caused Rusty to flee, upheaval in the household, for example, or a marauding feline foe, but Tim was adamant that, as far as he was concerned, nothing had changed. "The elderly lady who lives in the opposite flat died last week, which is quite upsetting," he said. "But other than that, things have been pretty humdrum around here. As for sightings, they'd drawn a blank in their own neighbourhood, but that morning had received calls from two separate witnesses in a village located a few miles away who claimed to have seen a cat answering Rusty's description in their respective gardens." "I doubt it's our cat, because she's never ever roamed that far," admitted Tim. "But we'd still like you to investigate, if you don't mind." "I'm more than happy to help," I replied, before casually mentioning that I'd be accompanied by a canine colleague. "My cocker spaniel, Molly, will be coming too," I said. "She's got a decent sense of smell and she doesn't yap at cats, so she might be quite useful. Hope that's okay with you." I was purposely downplaying things so as not to heap any pressure upon Molly or myself. "No problem," said Tim. "Anything that might help us find Rusty is fine with me." I burned the midnight all that evening, poring over digital maps, plans and photos of St. Albans area as Sarah slept beside me. It was important I found out as much as possible about the area to give Molly and me the best chance of locating the missing cat. When I felt myself beginning to nod off, I shut down my laptop and went to check on Molly, as I did every night. She sensed me peering through the gap in the door, raised her head and drowsily opened one eye. "We've got a big day ahead, young lady," I whispered. "So I'll see you bright and early in the morning." "Yeah, I know, Dad," Molly seemed to say. "So how's about you letting me get some sleep?" She held my gaze for a couple of seconds before curling up tight and continuing her slumbers. We both left the house at 5 a.m. The weather forecast had correctly predicted a cool and cloudy day with a slight underlying breeze. The perfect conditions for our big search, I hoped. Sarah had awoken early to wave us off, fully aware of the magnitude of the next few hours. She had watched me build up to this moment for a long time and knew exactly how much it meant to me. "Hope it all goes well, darling," she smiled. I almost did a double take when she gently, yet gingerly, patted my spaniel's glossy black head before wishing her good luck. Sarah hadn't quite acclimatized to Molly's presence in the household. She was no dog lover, put it that way, and this was indeed a rare display of affection. My dog quite literally lapped it up, giving my girlfriend's palm a big sloppy lick in return for her kind words. I smiled to myself, imagining Sarah darting straight to the antiseptic hand wash as soon as she returned indoors. Following a 2-hour drive from West Sussex to Hertfordshire, I was greeted by Tim and Jasmine outside their modern 4-story apartment block. They were young, fair-haired and athletic-looking. I guess they were in their mid-20s. But both wore a kind of glazed expression that I'd recognised only too well. Like many of my clients before them, their precious pet had gone AWOL and they were sick to the stomachs with worry. My eye was drawn to a huge poster in the front window. "Please help, I'm lost," it declared. "Can you help me find my home?" Staring out from behind the printed text was a beautiful photograph of the missing Moggy. Rusty was a pretty cat with a friendly face. Her white bib and legs, topped with two black splodges above her eyes, made her look like a feline caped crusader. "I wish all my clients could produce something so professional looking," I said. "Being a graphic designer comes in handy sometimes," replied Tim with a wan smile. "Now Rusty is a dream to photograph," added Jasmine wistfully. I followed the couple indoors, leaving Molly safe and secure in the car, and, as always, in my line of vision, with a favorite toy for company. I knew that she'd experience serious sensory overload if she entered an unfamiliar flat, and I needed her to remain as calm as possible. Not only that, it was imperative that she was able to focus solely on Rusty's scent if I was going to be lucky enough to obtain a decent sample. The three of us then discussed a plan of action. Jasmine had to attend work that morning. Her Monday clinic was always busy with sporting injuries, so Tim would be accompanying Molly and me on the search. Our first port of call would be the nearby village in which the two cat sightings had occurred, but before we set off, I posed a question. "I know this may sound a little odd, Tim, but would you mind if I took a sample of Rusty's cat hair?" I asked cautiously. "Molly's a trained sniffer dog, and you never know, she might detect some scent." I was soft-pedaling, of course, keeping things nicely understated. I needed to manage his expectations rather than having him believe that the deployment of a search dog would guarantee Rusty's recovery. "Yeah, sure, help yourself," he replied. "She molts a lot. Her cat bed's full of it." Out came my sterilized jam jar and in went a wad of whitish hair, more than enough for Molly to get her amazing nose into. The hamlet of Broomfield comprised a smattering of small cottages surrounded by acres of ancient woodland. The grass verges lining the lane were swathed in daffodils and narcissi, the petals and trumpets ranging in colour from vanilla white to egg yolk yellow. Nest-building blackbirds flitted from hedge to shrub, straw and twigs clamped firmly in their beaks. We parked up in a pub car park, where I strapped on Molly's special harness and zipped up my UKPD fleece. She and I had often practiced the transition from pet mode to work mode at Bramble Hill Farm, and donning our respective uniforms had always been a vital part of this routine. I was buzzing with excitement, but did my utmost to adopt a professional demeanour. Molly picked up on my nervous energy, however, and started whining and spinning around in her crate. As Tim and I surveyed our surroundings, a brisk wind began to whip up, with enough vigour to ruffle our hair. This wasn't forecast, I thought to myself. I looked to the horizon and saw the telltale signs of a warm front heading our way. I knew this would bring steady winds for the rest of the day, followed by rain. I did a quick calculation of the wind speed. I figured that we had 6 hours before the first band of rain reached us. "We really need to get started, Tim," I said, looking at my watch. "Okay," he said, "let's go for it." Tim and I swiftly identified the two gardens that Rusty had reportedly been sighted in. They were on the opposite sides of the road, and, fortunately, both householders allowed us access. Then, with a deep breath and my heart racing, I introduced Rusty's cat hair sample to Molly for the first time. I could see Tim's eyes widen with a mixture of surprise and fascination as I unscrewed the jam jar and, following my customary command of toma, the Spanish translation of take, I offered it up to Molly's snout. This distinctive word had been carefully selected by Molly's trainers at MDD, since she'd never hear it spoken around the house or within any other context. She inhaled the scent, awaited my usual exhortation to seek, seek, and careered off into the first garden, her tail wagging furiously. "Oh, wow," said my client, slowly twigging onto the fact that Molly was not your average dog. Has she been trained to do this?" "She has," I smiled. "But Tim, you need to know that this is a first live search and it would be unfair on you and Molly if I was to promise anything. But she'll do her very best to find Rusty. I can assure you of that. Molly searched everywhere for the odour, beneath a holly bush, inside the greenhouse, behind the compost heap, but to no avail. All the while she increased her eye contact with me, which, as I knew from many training searches, meant that she'd finished sweeping the area. "There's no cat here, Dad. Let's go," was how I deciphered her body language. It was a similar story in the second garden. Molly failed to locate any scent trails, and such was my faith in her ability, I could only surmise that Rusty had never ventured there. However, as I recalled my dog with a command of, "Molly, come," I suddenly noticed a black, grey and tan cat tiptoeing across the lawn. I squinted as it came closer. "Oh my goodness," I thought, "is that Rusty walking towards me?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.